Good evening. Welcome to TIFF Cinematheque. My name is Andrea Picard, and I'm one of the programmers for TIFF. And what a great pleasure to see a full house for Jeanne Dielman, 23 Quai du Commerce, 1080 Bruxelles. I feel like we don't say the full title enough, by Chantal Akerman, one of the best films of all time. And I think this is a film that is endlessly referenced, but also not watched enough in the cinema. So I'm so glad to see you all here tonight. This film is part of News from Home, our very large retrospective on Chantal Akerman, which runs until December 14th. And it was curated by myself and Claire Atherton, who worked with Chantal for 30 years as an editor. And she's here with us. So I'm going to bring her up on stage in a moment. But to begin, we would like to acknowledge that tonight's event is taking place on the territory of the Mississaugas of the Credit First Nation, the traditional territory of the Haudenosaunee, the Anishinaabe, and the Huron-Wendat. And we are tremendously grateful to be working in the community. On behalf of TIFF, I would like to thank our lead sponsor, Bell, our major sponsors, RBC, L'Oréal Paris, and Visa, and TIFF Cinematheque's public supporters, Ontario Creates, and Canada Council for the Arts. As a charitable organization, we would also like to thank our donors and our members for making TIFF's year-round activities, our programming, our educational and outreach initiatives possible. We would also like to thank our program sponsors, Classic FM Radio and Zoomer Radio, for their support. Additionally, we would like to thank LINA, the Institut National de l'Audiovisuel de Paris, for their program support. And now Claire, who's with us, I'm going to ask her to come up on stage. So last night was the launch of the retrospective, and we launched with News from Home from 1977. And Claire and I discussed the first three films that we would show over the opening weekend. So initially, we had thought we would just go chronological to give you a sense of the progression in Chantal's oeuvre. But then we thought, how could we not start with the big ones? And I think I was being a little selfish at one point, and I wanted to include Les Rendezvous d'Anna. I don't know if you remember, we had this conversation on opening weekend. I think it's a brilliant film that's sometimes eclipsed because it did follow the monument that is Jeanne Dielman. And then I think we took a week off from discussing the series, and then we both sent an email and said, okay, we have to put Jeanne on opening weekend. Let's not exaggerate a little bit. So I introduced Claire last night. She started working with Chantal on Letters Home, which is a film that we're also including from 1986, which is not very well known in North America. And so I hope you see that as well. In addition to all the iconic works, we spent a long time researching all of the rights and prints and digital copies for Chantal's short films, her TV works as well. So it's so great to see you all here for a film that's very well known. And I hope some of you are seeing it for the first time. But I also urge you to see all the rarities because there are films that have never screened in North America before. So now, even though Claire did not work on this film, she knows Chantal's work like the back of her hand. And so I'm going to ask her to introduce Jeanne tonight.
Thank you very much, Andrea. It's true. We took a little time to decide to begin with Jeanne. It's very moving for me to see the title of the event of tonight, Jeanne Dielman with Claire Atherton. It's a big honor, and thank you. No, really. Yes, the common point between Letters Home and Jeanne Dielman is Delphine Seyrig. I don't know if you know that. As Andrea told you, there are not many people who know Letters Home here, but not in France either. It's really a very rare film, so if you can come back and see Delphine in another of Chantal's movie, it would be great. Well, it's difficult to introduce a monument. So maybe what I can tell you about this film is when I discovered it. I was very young. I was 12. And if I saw it that young, it's because it's thanks to Delphine, because it's I knew Delphine when I was a kid. She was a friend of my mother, and that's and it's through Delphine that I met Chantal a few years after that. But I went to see the film. I was about, because the film was 75, no? Yeah, I was about 12 or 13, and I have I remember that I didn't understand much, and I didn't know what was said to me. But I felt something very, very strong getting in my body, and something that I would never forget. And I never forgot the impression. I forgot a little bit the film, of course, with the years, and I saw it after some other times. And I didn't really understand what was happening. I didn't know what she wanted to tell me. But I think it's a sign of the fact that I was feeling so much intensity. It's the proof of this, the strength of this film, which is beyond its subject. It doesn't have one subject. It doesn't have one purpose. It's a film to feel and to receive, as every film, but this one in particular, with your whole body, and not try to understand everything right away, because it's a film that works in your head and in your heart for a long, long, long time. And it's I think if it's so strong, it's probably because it's the fruit or the result of it's the intersection of many paths of Chantal, and of it's like if at the first time she told me the first time that she wanted to write, she had to write a script of a kind of feminist a feminist script about the life of a woman, but she thought that she didn't find her way, because she thought that every scene that she was thinking of was becoming an illustration of a purpose, and it wasn't her profound desire. It was just an idea, and after she realized that this film was really linked to her mother, and so she thought that she would just film this woman for three days of the life of a woman, and she didn't know much more. And it's while doing it, and even after, that she realized all the subjects that it crosses, this film. And I think that's why it's so strong, and that's why even when you're 12 years old, you feel things. It's because it's very, very full of many, many paths. And it's a film, you could say, about a woman. It's not a portrait, but it's a film about a woman. It's a film about anguish also, about how you fight against it and how you build the time to have things to do, to not be swollen by anguish. It's a film about feminism, about potatoes, about time, Chantal's mother loved this film, and in particularly she loved the scene with the potatoes. She said that it was so strong, and everything was in this scene, that we could anybody could feel everything in this scene. So just look at it. Just don't feel too much that it's a monument, that's an iconic film, because otherwise you each minute will feel and wonder what you missed. You can't miss anything. It's just happening there, and maybe you'll understand in 2 days, maybe in 2 years, and maybe never. But it'll get into you. I say that for, of course, for people who've never seen it. I hope there are some. And maybe I'd like also to share with you a little story about how Chantal met Delphine for this film, because as I told you yesterday, she was very I was always impressed about her way of being there, being present in every situation. And what I didn't tell you is how she could meet people so strongly. And she knew very fast who she wanted to work with, who she wanted to meet or not. She didn't ask for anything, for any diploma. She didn't ask anything to work with me. It was just like, you know, we met on a shooting. Well, and how she met Delphine, I love this story because it was at the occasion of a festival in Paris of women's film, or I don't exactly know what it was, but it was in Action République in Paris. And Delphine was there to present diaporama. How do you say that? Diaporama in English? Diaporama. About a woman in Vietnam that she had made with friends. And Chantal was there to present Saute ma ville. And Chantal was programmed at 8 o'clock, and Delphine's diaporama was programmed at 11 or something. Maybe the details are not good, but and Delphine came and asked Chantal if they could switch, because she wanted many people to see her diaporama to help the Vietnamese woman. And so Chantal looked at Delphine and she said, okay, but one condition, you stay for my film. And so Delphine said, okay. And so Delphine stayed. And she watched Saute ma ville and she loved it. And then she decided that she realized that she had met really somebody special. She wrote, Delphine wrote to her son about that, about this meeting the day after or a few days after. All the details are not good. So she realized that she had met someone, really someone, as you say, I met someone. And so when Chantal asked her to play in Jeanne Dielman, she said yes. And maybe if they hadn't met like this, maybe it would have been more difficult. So, and that again is a way of showing or make you share this way of being there that had always Chantal and her look and her gaze that was so strong and her way of being always so untired and so, I don't know how to say, but so, and this way of being makes so many things possible. So I think I don't want to talk much more because the film is quite long, and I hope that you will we will have a little strength left to talk a little bit after. Thank you.
Oh, it's okay. We realized you didn't work on this film, and the applause was for Chantal. When the film ended, but also because you're here with us this weekend and we want to take advantage. And you also co-curated this series, so plenty of applause.
Please welcome to the stage Andrea Pica.
Merci beaucoup. difficult to speak after a film like this. It's so heavy. And also, it will never fail to astonish me that Chantal was 25 years old when she made this film, which is incredible. It's also interesting to see this film back to back with News from Home, and we showed them in a reverse order. But for those of you who were here last night, I don't know if you feel the same way, but when Jeanne was reading the letter about the cousin in Canada, it felt very much in the same tone and rhythm that Chantal used when she read the letters of her mother in News from Home. So just to go back to this idea of musicality as well, you know, there's so many sounds and noise and clicking and clacking and lights on and off. It's like this musical nature that Chantal carried through so many of her films.
Yeah, it's true. I think, in fact, maybe cinema is a sort of a music. A kind of a music when you really get it into when you touch the real cinema. When I say touching the real cinema, it's to respect the powerness of the the power of the image in its by itself, and not just use the image to say something, but just receive the image. And you were asking, we were talking yesterday about frontality. I think frontality is also a direction of look. It's looking that way and not showing everything, but just sharing a direction of look. It's, you know, today we have in some films, in my opinion, too much the some films want to show too much, and especially with the sound. So we go back to the music. It's like if we put microphone everywhere so that you can hear everything, every single thing that happens on the other hand of, on the other side of the, or backwards or very far. So it's like if you want to show or make hear everything, and so there is no choice anymore. You see what I'm trying to say, and with this choice of Chantal of frontality, of giving a direction of looking, it's a choice, and it makes a tension that is the heart beating of the film, and creates also the music. Everything is linked, all the
and the patterns and the art direction. Obviously, yeah. It's funny that this film is referred to as minimalist so many times. Yeah. And watching it again in the cinema, it's riveting. She is always moving, and there are so many gestures and patterns and reflections, and it's maximalist, not minimalist.
Because all the little things become big also. Mm.
True. I'd like to open it up to the audience. Mm. Are there questions right here? Oh, sorry, there are microphones. Thank you.
Does the Jeanne Dielman character not read except when she has to? That's one thing I noticed when she talks about how her husband was a reader and her son is always reading, and it's comic, the repetition. If the third day had continued, no doubt she would have told him not to read while eating. I just wondered about that. That's just one little thing I noticed. Or am I?
I don't know.
I mean, the one thing I could say, I can't speak for Chantal, obviously, and there are various interpretations, but the fact of reading and letters and language, I think, is something that was always important to her, and she spoke about that as well. And I was rereading or listening to an interview that she gave today, in fact, and she said that it was linked to the idea of rituals as well. So like the folding, the reading, which she said in some subconscious way might have been linked to rituals of her childhood, not only of her mother, but of Jewish rituals that had sort of become more domestic rituals. So perhaps it could be linked with that.
Yeah. Of course, reading is I didn't think of link of the link between reading and rituals, but yes, but it's true that the rituals in that film are very important, but they are important. They were important in Chantal's life. Even if she was not organized like Jeanne, that's Sylviane is laughing because that seems to be kind of obvious. Not only Sylviane is laughing.
I should mention Sylviane is Chantal's sister, who's with us for the weekend.
Yeah. but at the same time, rituals were. I know, for example, that in the editing process, the rituals were important for us. The rhythm of the days, the fact that each time I was arriving, we had a little coffee. And she had. I told you yesterday that when we went to headed to La Captive. We were going there by car, and she was saying the same sentences each morning, talking about the color of the sky, which was either blue tender or as gray as a mouse. And then she would say that she would call her mother, and that there were all other rituals, like having a coffee every morning and then go to the editing suite, yes, and then begin to look at the rushes and write in a certain way, and then she would go and have a moment with phone calls, and you know, like. And always, and when the films we was about to exist, began to exist, and we had 10 minutes or 15 minutes to look, it was always in the morning that we were looking. You know, like things that were rhythming the day, always. That was, even if she wasn't organized, there were those little... yes, there were like
gestures
and like you know, a pulsation of rhythm, you know, rythme,
like a
drumming,
yeah. Percussion.
Yeah.
Right here in the middle.
First off, I'd like to thank you so much for being here to talk a little bit about this film and shine some light on Chantel's method. Speaking as an editor, I wanted to see if you had some insight onto looking at this film, what you think some of the biggest challenges of putting the edit together for this film. I mean, thinking first and foremost about how long some of these takes are. I'm interested in how many takes, how long some of these scenes and shots are, how many takes Chantel would go into a scene with, or maybe something along those lines.
Yeah, it's difficult for me because, as I told you before, I was 12, so I didn't really know even what was editing at that time. So I don't know how many takes she, and I'm not a searcher. You know, I didn't ask her so much. It's funny because I didn't ask Chantal so much of things about her memories and how things would happen, because I had this habit not to ask her too many questions when she would was talking to me about a film she wanted to make, or about it, how went the shooting, or she would tell me what she wanted, but I didn't ask too many questions because I always liked the mystery. It's for me part of my practice of editing. I don't want to understand because I have a very logical mind, and if I begin to understand, everything is finished. I have to keep this mystery floating, so I don't ask too many questions. So I didn't say, oh, how did you edit Jeanne Dielman? Maybe I should. Sometimes I regret today, but life, you regret and many things, and you don't regret because that's the choice. The choice is to put one feet after another and go, and then some things you do and some things you don't do, and that's linked to the also the direction of look, you know, the choice, which is not a choice that you have to explain, but it's just a way of being, of looking. So why did I ask? I didn't answer your question at all, but I know I didn't. I don't pretend I do, but it's just to explain why I can't answer really. What I can just say is that when we were editing with Chantal, it was never difficult to make the choices. It was like if things would come to us very easily. It was just a way of being and of receiving, and a way of listening to the instinct, also to look at her, how she was looking at the images, because her body was very expressive. So sometimes she had even a way of breathing when she was looking at, you know, some images. So I was just like receiving everything the images, the sound, her desire, her presence, and put things together. And very fast, I always begin the editing by the first shot. And when the film begins to exist, we were looking at it in the morning, and each day was a little bit longer. And it came in very, like, so I think that for this film, it might have been some kind of maybe a little bit the same, but I can't say that. What I can say is that she didn't shoot, she never shot very much. It's not, she didn't shoot 25, except for in one film, Couch in New York, because there was a big pressure on her because of a very expensive film, expensive actors. And so the producer really wanted her to as they told her, to cover herself. So, but she, it was for her, it made her suffocating. And she told me it's not a blanket anymore. It's mattresses on me. I can't breathe anymore. All those takes that they want me to do. So. Excuse me. So it's not it's wasn't her habit to shoot a lot. That I can say.
But just something I would add, it is just semi related, is that, you know, many people think that there's a lot of improvisation with this film because it, you know, has a quasi ethnographic or documentary feel. But she used to say that this was one of her most written films, that everything was very written out, including all of the gestures. Mm. And the precision that you spoke about earlier, or maybe privately, about directing Delphine as well.
Yeah, yeah, she was, that I know, and you can know, because, I mean, there is a film that has been made by her and Sami Frey about the shooting. And in this film, you see Chantal directing Delphine. So that, it's difficult to find it, but maybe one day. it's in the box of the coffret des années 70, comment tu dis?
The 1970s box set.
Yeah. It's the bonus of Jeanne Dielman. And you see how precisely she gives the advices to how to make the gesture. So everything was very, very precise. But as we were talking about the right before the screening with Andrea, it was very precise. All the physical aspects were very precise. But as I told you before, she didn't really know where she was going, but she just knew the physical aspect. It's and Sylvian told me that it was very all the relation with the meals, it's linked to their aunt, because their aunt, they knew exactly what meal they would have what day, and she told me that I shouldn't have talked so much about the potatoes before the, because what was important was the veal. Voilà, which was one particular day in the week, and that's what's it's all this ritual and those meals and all those gestures and the noise of the footsteps and the corridor and everything. That's what made her gave her the desire to make the film. That's the familiarity and the loving gaze, as we said yesterday also. That was what helped her to make the film. It wasn't the rest. The rest comes after. The rest comes, I mean, when I say the rest, it's what it's make us think about anguish, about rituals, about letters, as the mistress said, about anything that any of you can pick. And even her, she realized things after. And so for me, it's very important, this way of considering cinema, which it comes from the deepness and it goes to a thinking. But it's the... it's the physicality that makes you think. And I think that's cinema and that's music.
Yes?
Thank you. First, I just want to say that I've seen this movie numerous times in my life, and Chantal has played a huge part in my own love of film. I do have a question in regards to the staging. Can you describe what exactly was Chantal's process like regarding staging each of Jeanne's routines throughout the 3 days?
C'est pas compris exactement.
Je pense que tu peux pas répondre vraiment. It's the staging.
Oui, la mise en place.
Ouais, comment elle a fait?
Non, je peux pas répondre. I'm sorry, but it's maybe it's, because you came to the shooting, no? Sometimes, Sylviane, no? No, because... dis-le en français, Sylviane.
C'est la mise en place des rituels dans le film. Comment elle a procédé?
C'est pas possible. We can't really know. We would invent and it's, you know... Yeah. No, but
I think it's more about Chantal's method, which is difficult because Claire didn't work on the film.
Yeah, I didn't work on the film. I thought maybe Sylviane could have said something because she came to the shooting sometimes. But I think it's no. The best thing it would be that you find this film about the shooting and see how. But I think it's really. I know her and I remember she was always very precise about, as I said, about the way, all the gestures, the way that she would push her hair and even everything. You see that it's like a dance.
It's a choreography.
Yeah, exactly like yesterday, but it's choreography of with bodies. Less characters, but...
Je vais le dire en français. C'est comme dans la vie normale, chacun a notre routine. Une femme va amener son enfant à l'école, va le rechercher, elle va lui faire à manger, et ça recommence le lendemain la même chose. Là, bon, elle reçoit chaque jour un client, un autre client, et le troisième jour, son rituel a été coupé. Pour quelque chose. Donc c'est dans la force de 1, 2, 3, je sais pas.
Talking about the quotidian rituals that we have of a woman taking care of a child and preparing meals, and then of course there is a cut, an abrupt cut on the third day.
But it's true that as yesterday, as in News from Home, there is also humor. I was happy when I came to the, because I didn't see the whole movie. I saw it not a long, il y a pas longtemps.
Not too long ago.
Not too long ago, yeah, thank you. And so I didn't see it today. But when I went into, came here, I heard the people laughing. It was very moving. Yeah, it is. There is a lot of humor in the film. With a baby, of course.
Yeah. And there's some great conversations that are had. There's not a lot of dialogue, but the conversations are really special.
Yeah, yeah.
Yes, in the back.
Thank you again for being here.
Thank you.
From your collaborative experience with Chantal, can you tell us a little bit more about, as an editor, what kind of a process you guys went through and what kind of direction she would give you as an editor? And also, do you know other than the from her personal experience and memories, is there any literary sources or cinematic sources as a sort of inspiration for her films? Films that she's or books that she's particularly looking up to.
Well, I'll let Claire talk about the editing in a moment, which she has done to some degree already. But Chantal had a great love of literature, obviously cinema. You know, she fell in love with cinema at a very young age when she was 15. The first film that she really loved was Pierrot le Fou. And you see that homage in her first film, Saute ma ville, which she made when she was 18 years old. So she was fully immersing herself. And then in the film that we showed last night, and there'll be a few others, she went to New York to really immerse herself in the New York underground films, which included, you know, Michael Snow, the Canadian who was living there at the time, and Jonas Mekas. And so she was very versatile in that way. But when you watch all of the films, you'll see that there is, you know, as we were talking about earlier, this love of language and literature and words, but also music. And music is a very strong thread throughout her film, whether it's classical music or just the musicality. Here we could say it's musique concrète. But in terms of literature also, you know, she tackled two hugely important books. And, you know, for someone who had made diary films and a comedy and a musical, she went for Conrad and Proust. So I think that speaks a lot to her love of literature as well.
Yeah, and about editing, it's very difficult to answer this question in 2 minutes because it would take hours to tell how we were editing, but it was the most important moment, I think, was the discovering of the images together. And we were not saying many things. We were just looking and we were sharing very simple words with our impressions and but never trying to break the mystery of the images, only saying that it was either beautiful or maybe too simple or fragile or strong, or, you know, talking about very like I said about the advices she was giving to her actors. We were talking a little bit the same, like if we were talking about concrete substance, you know, and not about psychological issues or and even when it was actors, we were talking about the voice, or it was real or not real, or that we like this smile, but it was never explaining, or, you know. So this immersion in the rushes, it was a very, very important moment. And then I told you right before, I always have the need to begin with the beginning. So we would put a first image and then try to put another one, and very quickly the film began to lead us, to talk to us and to help us to find the way. And, well, I tried to make it not too long because I want us to stay with Jeanne Dielman, but maybe tomorrow I can talk a little bit if you come for this, or I don't want to, or I can give you... Thank you.
We have time for one more question. Yes, right here.
Hi, thank you. You said something at the beginning that I liked very much, that this is not a portrait. And it's very much not a portrait. And I think, like, for the audience, for today's audience, part of what makes it so much not a portrait is the distance between the actress and the character, and knowing the actress as this, you know, feminist. And so that sort of distance makes it so extraordinary, that relation between the actress and the character. I'm just curious how much, well, two things, how much Delphine Seyrig was very much who she had in mind from the beginning, and what did the audience know, the audience at the time, this is a question I guess for both of you, about Seyrig as a feminist, as an activist. She was also someone very glamorous and an activist. And so on both accounts, there's a distance between the actress and the character, which I think works extraordinarily well.
I'm not sure that people knew that well at that time that Delphine Seyrig was a feminist. I don't think so. It's funny because this film is 75 and she made the Maso et Miso vont en bateau in 76, which is now a little bit well known. It's a feminist and very, very funny video that Delphine made. But I don't think that people knew that well. I think Delphine Seyrig was more an iconic, no, at that time.
I think Chantal knew, and when they met.
Chantal, yes, but it was about the public, your question, yeah. No?
I think Chantal did talk about this, and that she really did, I think, after her encounter, which you said left such an impression on her. She was very aware of the public persona that Delphine had, this very glamorous sort of haute bourgeoise, you know, image. And I think that was very important to her. And she said she wrote it, I don't know if this is entirely true, but she said that she wrote it with Delphine in mind because she was putting on screen these memories from her childhood that were sort of banal in a way. You know, the making of the schnitzel and the potatoes and folding of the laundry. And she said, I want people to pay attention to that. And so you have this very beautiful woman. Sure, she's a bit, you know, frumpy or her hair, but she's still gorgeous. And I also noticed that she's wearing high heels with her, what do you call that? Her house coat. Thank you. So she was very aware of that disjunction. And I think she wanted to play with the contrast. And in a sense, she wanted to woo the audience because it's Delphine, but to have her perform over and over again the most banal and invisible chores and duties. So
yeah, but I'm not sure that people. I think people knew Delphine Seyrig more as an iconic and
exactly.
gorgeous and not that. I think so. I just want to add something because talking about Delphine Seyrig as a feminist, there is an exhibition in Madrid right now about Delphine and Soumuse. And I talk about this because in this exhibition is shown an installation of Chantal Akerman, because Chantal also made installations. I don't know if you know about that. And this one is Elisabeth de Beauvici wrote in her article about the exhibition, it's like the heart of the exhibition. And it's called Woman Sitting After Killing. And it's the last shot of this film on 7 monitors and décalé.
Out of order.
Spread out. And it's when you see 7 times this last shot on monitors on like a arc of circle like this, it's something else than the film, but it's so strong, you can walk and go closer to her and then get far again and I don't know. It's another way of telling this story.
I should also mention that if you have more questions about the cinematography in the film, you should come back next Wednesday night because Babette Mangold, who shot the film, will be with us to discuss her her work with Chantal. I'm afraid we're out of time. I want to thank everybody for being here and also to remind you that Claire will be here tomorrow afternoon at 5:45 to present Dest, a film that she did edit and we both love very much. Thank you.